Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 11042 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 11042 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is a debate on motion 11027. In the name of Paul McLennan on Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. I'd be grateful if members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Paul McLennan to speak to and move the motion. Up to 13 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to bring today's debate to the Chamber this afternoon to have this opportunity to provide an update on our approach to delivering the right homes and the right places for our rural and island communities. Access to high-quality homes that are affordable and meet the needs of people in the place they want to be is central to the ambitions of the Scottish Government and critical to supporting the First Minister's three overarching and defining missions of equality, opportunity and community. Housing of the right type in the right place can have a powerful and generational impact, supporting people to access the housing they need, enabling young people to stay in the communities in which they grew up and supporting local businesses to retain and attract employees. Our long-term housing strategy, Housing to 2040, has at its core an ambition for everyone to have a safe, high-quality home that is affordable and meets their needs in the place they want to be. That applies as much to rural and island areas as it does in urban areas. Following the publication of Housing to 2040, we committed as part of the Bute House Agreement to developing a Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. Over the summer, I met with organisations including the Scottish Land Commission, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, South of Scotland Enterprise, the Scottish Council for Development and Industry, amongst others, and I want to thank them for their input, and indeed to everyone who participated for sharing their views, the groups and individuals who are part of rural and island communities who know what works and what doesn't, who have seen firsthand the difference that the right home and the right place makes, have all shaped the content of our plan. Now, one of the key things, as I talked around about meeting some of the organisations, was about the challenges of Brexit, and I'd be amiss of me not to mention this, as it was mentioned to me on numerous occasions. So we know there are challenges ahead. Years of the UK government's economic mismanagement, coupled with a hard Brexit, have had long-lasting, devastating impact on our rural and island communities. But that will not stop our ambition, which is set out in this plan, nor will it blemish our record of delivering thousands of affordable homes in these areas. The Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan provides a vital opportunity to take forward key actions to support housing and local economies and help accelerate inclusive economic growth. We are making available £3.5 billion over this parliamentary term to support delivery of 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, 70% of which will be for social rent and 10% in our rural and island areas. As part of our £752 million programme this year, we have also committed to invest £60 million in a national acquisition plan to help increase the pace of delivering affordable homes. There has already been a lot of good work achieved through joint working cooperation that is delivering good housing outcomes for rural and island communities. Since 2016, this government has supported delivery of over 10,000 affordable homes across our rural and island areas. During the summer, I visited projects in Gairloch, Fort Augustus, Shetland, and Kelso, and yesterday I visited a new affordable homes development in Guildtown in Perthshire, and I've heard firsthand about the difference these affordable homes have made to local communities. Let me share some examples of how strong collaborative working has delivered more homes for our rural and island communities. Working with North Ayrshire Council, we delivered the first new council homes in Arran for more than 20 years with 34 affordable homes in Brodick. Some of these homes were let by North Ayrshire Council to key workers, helping them to live and work in the local area. Working with Argyll and Bute Council and Link Group, a new development of over 300 affordable homes has been delivered in Dunbeg. All of the homes have air source heat pumps to deliver affordable energy and tackle fuel poverty in an area that is off-grid. I've also seen firsthand the 12 homes completed in the Fort Augustus by the local community company, which is looking to deliver more community-led homes, and I'll touch on that later on. And I heard directly from a tenant whose homes had meant to him, allowing him to stay in his own home within his own local community. We also supported Eildon Housing Association to deliver 57 energy-efficient homes in Chirnside and the Scottish Borders. Through our Affordable Housing Supply Programme, our Affordable Housing Investment Benchmark levels recognise the differential in costs to deliver affordable housing in rural and island locations, as opposed to City and Embarneras, and be trying to be as flexible as possible. Our demand-led route... Yeah, of course.
Michelle Thompson.
Noting your point about the finance, I wonder if he could share with me what activities he's been doing to ensure that the right type of finance with the right risk profile is available for SMEs, given that we want that breadth and diversity in our providers.
Minister.
Thank Michelle Thompson for that question. A number of things. Just about 2 weeks ago, I met 25 institutional investors in London talking about opportunities to invest in housing in Scotland. That was a positive meeting, and we're meeting up again very soon talking about that. That doesn't MMR and BTR, it also includes social housing. I also met recently with Scottish Financial Enterprise. Another roundtable coming up with them talking around about the opportunities for how we help finance rural housing in particular and housing in general. So again, positive and happy to feedback on the roundtable once we have that. So just coming back to the point, obviously we mentioned about the demand-led rural islands housing fund, which has been described as a game changer, has now become a recognised feature of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme and is backed up by £30 million funding this parliamentary term. Now, I try and make as many local authorities as possible since I've been in role, and probably met over two-thirds of them. So again, this issue is raised when I talk to councils. Yep.
Fergus Ewing.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way. On 1st of September, I wrote to the Minister suggesting that in order to meet the laudable aims of 11,000 affordable homes by 2032, he should work very closely with farmers, with landowners, and he should use permitted development of up to five new homes, not simply conversion of existing, but new homes per farm unit. Given that farms cover 71% of the landmass of Scotland and that the average farm has an equity of around £1 million, is this not a sleeping giant desperate to be woken up by the Scottish Government? And why is the Scottish Government not included this proposal in the plan?
Minister.
Can I thank Fergus Ewing for the question? It's something I think it would be considered in terms of engaging with stakeholders. We met with NFU, we met with the Crofting Commission as well, also met with the SLE and talked about these particular issues. So these, are things that are mentioned in the plan, which we'll try and develop. And I would agree with Fergus Ewing. I think there's a great opportunity working with landowners and farmers in terms of that. So the discussions with them will continue as the plan moves forward. So just coming back to that and talking about the Rural and Islands Housing Fund, I talked around about £30 million funding this parliamentary term. That continues to play an important part in helping community organisations and others to develop affordable homes, while complementing delivery through our mainstream programme by councils and housing associations in rural and island areas. Now, I say we have a strong track record, having delivered over 10,000 affordable homes since 2016. However, we recognise we need to do more. The Rural and Islands Housing Plan sets out our next steps. We know that providing affordable housing in rural and island areas can be complex and that a one-size-fits-all does not work. Many of these actions, including action plans, seek to address key challenges and put in place the systems and support for the delivery of the right homes in the right places so that our rural and island communities can thrive. I'd also like to highlight some of the key actions included in the plan. And key workers, now I know this issue has been raised in correspondence myself by a number of members. So the key workers, obviously, the plan recognises the importance of employers being able to attract and retain key workers in rural and island areas, not only to support service delivery for communities, but also to support economic growth and prosperity. Now, I've met a number of employers already talking in the debate about some of the schemes that have come forward, and we continue to work with them in that regard in close partnership. It also includes an action to allocate up to £25 million from our affordable homes budget over the next 5 years to fund the purchase or long leasing of properties, including empty houses, to be turned into key homes for key workers and others who need affordable housing. Now, I know... Yeah?
Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I thank the Minister for giving way. There are 67,000 unoccupied properties in Scotland right now, and we all know in our own constituencies that they are unsightly and they're a blight on Scotland. Does the Minister agree that there should be compulsory introduction of compulsory sales order to ensure that these properties are given to people who are needing homes?
Minister.
Yeah, and I think that's a good point that's been raised by Rachel Hamilton. I think there was a report out by the Empty Homes Partnership which touched on that issue, and obviously they sent it into Scottish Government. So that's been considered at the moment. They did mention that at that particular time. So, it would be good to come back to yourself on that particular issue, but that is something that Empty Homes Partnership and ourselves are working on, the recommendations they made of that, not just in rural areas, but right across Scotland as well. So it's a key part of that, and happy to discuss it after this as well. So again, you know, it's an issue that's really important in terms of the key workers. We're seeing economic development opportunities, but we can't really, you know, expand or try and maximise opportunities around about these without having housing that's there. I was up visiting around about Nigg and Invergordon and seeing the number of houses that will be required to accommodate workers up there. So it's incredibly important around about what we need to do in that role. So the plan also recognises that employers, including those in the public sector, have a role to play there, including through the better use of resources, properties and land they may be owned to meet shared interests of supporting the provision of homes for key workers. We know that availability is... Yeah, I'll take one because I'm conscious of the time.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Minister for taking the intervention. Given that 17% of Scotland's population lives in rural areas and we're seeing depopulation, do you think people in rural areas should be satisfied with only getting 10% of the 110,000 homes that have been promised for Scotland?
Minister.
Yeah, I think we talked around about a minimum of 10%, and I think, you know, that's one of the key things. Now, obviously, I meet with local authorities, we meet with developers, we meet with obviously economic development partners as well in terms of that. So it's trying to identify the right houses in the right places. So 10% is a minimum. If we can achieve more than that, then fantastic. But that includes closer working, as mentioned here in the Rural Housing Action Plan. So that's a minimum that I would like to deliver. If we can deliver more, then fantastic. But I think at the moment the target that's been set is realistic. I think we've proven that in the delivery that's there. But if we meet more than that, you know, I think that would be great. So I talked about land for housing. So we know the availability of suitable land in right locations is also vital to enable the delivery of more homes where they're required. Building on the range of activity that's already underway, the plan commits to working with the public sector agencies to consider the land and building assets they hold that may be appropriate for housing. And we held a round table in Perth, probably around about 2 or 3 months, probably around about 10 stakeholders, and that was a key issue that we discussed at that particular time. Now, our National Planning Framework 4 sets out policies which include strong support for sustainable rural development. This includes a new national planning policy for rural homes, which will encourage, promote and facilitate delivery of more high-quality, affordable and sustainable rural homes. The plan also recognises alongside delivery of new homes for our rural island communities, that it is important that local authorities have the tools available to allow them to make the best use of existing housing. And I want to touch a little bit on second homes in short-term lets. Now, I know these have been emotive issues and we've had that debate. So second homes and short-term lets can also bring benefits to those who own and use them, as well as to the tourism business and local economy that they support. However, these kind of ownership patterns impact on availability of homes to meet local needs and on community sustainability. We are considering what additional powers could support local areas to take action. This was mentioned to myself on the tour that I undertook in the summer on numerous occasions. So this includes intent to bring forward legislation giving local authorities the power to charge up to 100% premium on second homes. On short-term lets, there's now a new legal requirement for short-term lets to be licensed, which provides assurance to guests that short-term lets can meet safety standards and that people providing them are suitable. This brings short-term lets in line with the regulation of other accommodation sectors, such as hotels, caravan parks and houses of multiple occupation. It also provides local areas with the option to apply additional conditions to address local issues with short-term lets where these are causing problems for neighbours and residents. Touching on the point that Rachel Hamilton made, I just want to say a wee bit more on empty homes. And we know that every empty home brought back into use can make a big difference to the sustainability of these communities, and we're committed to working with the Scottish Empty Homes Partnership, local authorities and owners to bring back more empty homes in rural and island areas back into use. The Scottish Homes Partnership and local authorities dedicated empty homes officers continue to deliver great results with more than 9,000 homes returned to use. On community-led housing, and you know this is incredibly important. Now, the plan recognises community-led housing plays an important role in our broad approach to deliver more affordable homes in our rural and island communities. The enabling role of organisations, including South of Scotland Community Housing and Community Housing Trust, who have both met, amongst others, have been and continue to be vital in supporting communities to bring forward housing projects. This plan includes a joint funding package with Nationwide Foundation of almost £1 million over 3 years to Community Housing Trust and South of Scotland Community Housing to enable them to continue to support rural and island communities, enable them to grow their knowledge and capacity and to deliver more affordable homes to meet the needs of communities. The action plan obviously touches on what we need to do, but this is all around about collaboration and partnership. The delivery of the ambitions in the action plan cannot solely be achieved by the Scottish Government and will require commitment, collaboration and dedication by a wide range of organisations, including government agencies, local authorities and others. The private sector also has a vital role to play, and I've met with Homes for Scotland on this issue also, as both employers and businesses with land and assets. I know that some are already engaging in providing quality homes for their employees. Presiding officer, in conclusion, I believe that delivery of the commitments of this action plan further enhance our commitment to addressing the key challenges that will enable the delivery of more homes across our rural and island communities, supporting them to thrive, and I look forward to seeing its progress. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Rachel Hamilton to speak to and move amendment 110.27.1, up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. Less than 1 week on from the revelation that our former First Minister could spare just one slot in her diary to the whole of rural Scotland over the past 2 years, can I start by saying that I'm pleased to see rural affairs back on the agenda firm and square here in Holyrood today. Scotland's towns, villages and rural communities and islands will be paying attention to this opportunity to listen to what this Parliament can do to tackle the challenges that they are facing. And I know there are a few greater challenges for them than stemming the tide of rural depopulation, which poses a threat to the sustainability of so many of our communities. Rural depopulation has been driven by years of neglect, years of not using devolved powers within this place, not just by the former First Minister, but by an SNP Green coalition that has shown time and time again that it does not understand the needs of rural communities. But the Cabinet Secretary is right, or the Minister is right, to say that housing is an important piece of the puzzle when it comes to solving this issue and setting out a plan to support the delivery of affordable homes, homes for key workers, and addressing supply chain issues in building homes in rural areas is, in my view, a genuinely positive step. I would add that acknowledging the fact that a one-size-fits-all approach does not always work and is not always progress, but too often we've seen this government take a copy-and-paste approach by using urban solutions to fix rural problems. The Rural Housing and Islands Action Plan is a welcome departure from that approach, but whilst it is a start, and no doubt a hard-fought one, in the face of government that has shown little interest in rural communities or solving the issues around rural depopulation, the facts and figures that underpin this action plan show that the government remain as out of touch with rural Scotland as ever. And before I go into the details of that, I think it's important that to set the debate in the right context, we must not forget that this plan is being launched on the back of a £170 million cut in Scotland's housing budget. It is also being launched with a backdrop of damaging rent controls that have done nothing but other than drive up rents, drive away investment and place a greater burden on people who want to rent a home than anywhere else in the UK. The private rented sector will be key to resolving housing shortages, but this government's rental measures have undoubtedly had a negative effect on the market. Increasing input costs has forced landlords to put prices up in a second between tenancies, whilst the disinvestment driven by this policy has reduced stock and increased competition. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Minister.
A couple of points. One on the budget. The budget at the start of parliamentary term was £3.5 billion and that's not been cut. I recognise the role, as you said, of the private rented sector, and met with John Blackwood on a number of occasions talking about that and in terms of how we work with him taking that forward. So you know, I would agree that's an important area going forward. In terms of the rent controls, obviously that the longer term issue about that will be addressed in the forthcoming housing bill. But working very closely with the private rented sector, not only in this area but in other parts of Scotland also. But I recognise the importance of the point that you raised.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for the intervention, but I mean, I'm just looking at the Scottish Government figures for 2022, where there is an actual cash terms cut in the housing budget. And this has done nothing to help the rural allocation, as highlighted by my colleague, Finlay Carson. Can I make some progress and perhaps take an intervention later? Against what the Minister's just said, that they're working with the private sector, it is absolutely key that that the actions that we take away from today from rural organisations such as the Scottish Association of Landlords and SLE, Scottish Land and Estates, who have provided a brief today, are taken forward. It's important that we do work with them and we listen to the voices of those people who are integral to providing houses within the private rental sector. They've argued strongly that arbitrary rent freezes and eviction bans harm both landlords and tenants. And that's really important because whilst making it harder to solve Scotland's housing crisis, the red tape and bureaucracy that we're seeing is having a huge impact. We've seen a £12 million underspend in rural and islands housing funds. And we've also seen repeated failures to meet targets for building affordable homes, with approval rates at their lowest level in 10 years. We've seen a 25% reduction in the delivery of social housing and a staggering 48,000 empty homes across the country, which the Minister addressed in the intervention. But of those, 1,000 properties in my own constituency in the Borders have been empty for over a year. And it doesn't go unnoticed by my constituents. They can't understand why these properties cannot be brought back for integral homes for them and their families in the next generation. Yes.
Thank you, Member, for letting me intervene on that. First of all, I'm not sure how you expect the Scottish Government to be able to deliver more homes with a £500 million cut in its capital budget, 9.7% in real terms this year, with 7% to 2028. And also, if the Scottish Government is doing so badly in delivering affordable homes, why are we delivering 13.9 homes per 10,000 population when the UK Tory Government is only managing two-thirds of that?
Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, what a shame that Kenny Gibson has to devolve his responsibilities to another government. Scotland has two governments. This place has huge devolved responsibilities, and they have a record block grant. Unfortunately, this is all they have to criticise, and I just think that people watching this debate today will look at that and think that, you know, the SNP just don't understand how to deal with the issues in rural Scotland, particularly around the lack of housing. It's just such a shame. But it's important that we consider the Housing Action Plan in the context of this debate today. And the reality of the plan is that, regardless of that context, rural areas are being shortchanged. Rural Scotland, as my colleague Finlay Carson said, accounts for 17% of Scotland's population, yet they've only been promised 10% of that affordable housing development budget. And that falls hopelessly short of their fair share. Well, if the Minister can tell people that live in rural communities why they're being shortchanged, yes.
And again, it comes back to the point, and the point I made to Mr Carson, the 10% is a minimum target. It's not around a budget around that. We continue to speak to local authorities on that. 10% is a minimum. If we can get more than that, it's not a budgetary spend. If we can deliver more than that, and there are opportunities to deliver that within the wider programme, we will deliver more than the 10%. 10% is a minimum target that we've set. So it's not a budgetary target around about 10%. If we have opportunities to work with local authorities in terms of that, and development groups and local communities, we will deliver more than that. So it's not a minimum, it's not a budget impact, and that's a 10% target.
I hear that the Minister wants to be more ambitious, but you know, why aren't we transparent and clear about what those ambitions are, rather than misleading people and sort of shortchanging rural communities? But the result of this deficit that we're talking about here for rural Scotland is an embedding inequality. It's widening the gap between what the SNP aspirations are for delivering for the central belt and what is failing to deliver for those small towns, those small villages and rural communities and our islands. And how many more ways is rural Scotland being let down by this coalition of SNP and Green members? Access to healthcare, road upgrades, broadband connectivity, ferries, to name but a few. Housing is key to tackling the problems they are facing. But as I said, it is only one piece of the puzzle. But if we can't even tackle this issue with a fair allocation of resources, but we have hope for that because the Minister has just articulated that, what hope is there for the rest of the challenges that people face in rural communities? We cannot keep treating rural Scotland as an afterthought in policy making, as second-class citizens. And that is exactly why we'll be bringing forward the Scottish Conservatives' plan to bring rural Scotland at the heart of our decision making. And on housing, we'll be pragmatic in our approach, encouraging investment rather than stymieing its flow. We will cut red tape and bureaucracy to speed up housing delivery. and the Scottish Conservatives would ensure that disincentivising legislation is assigned to the circular file. We'll announce plans to overhaul the planning process to make it easier to build new homes in the right places, and we'll do a lot more. But first and foremost, we'll ensure that at least 17% of that housing budget and the building of affordable homes would be delivered in rural areas. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call on Mark Griffin to speak to and move Amendment 11027.2. Up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And before I begin, draw members' attention to my register of interests, which shows that I ceased to be a landlord this summer. Today's debate is as much about housing as it is about the future prosperity and, in fact, the very existence of rural communities. And so while this debate, the debate is welcome, that it has taken the SNP government 16 years to produce a rural housing action plan, I think speaks for itself. People in rural communities have waited far too long for workable solutions to this government's housing crisis, and yet the government motion offers little new. We can't support a motion today that doesn't face up to reality or an action plan short on action. It's a missed opportunity. And it's no understatement that housing is a lifeline to rural communities. The shortage of rural, remote and island housing is having devastating impact on local economies. Just like the ferries fiascos and creaking transport infrastructure, the shortage is both the symptom and the cause of depopulation, driving people away from their local areas, from their families, from their support networks, and the jobs they want to work in. And though I appreciate what the Minister had to say in his opening speech, I want to ask the government, will they admit, as the Empty Homes Partnership have put it, that we have a rural housing emergency? And I ask that because there seems to be little urgency to address rural Scotland's needs or the package of policies and funding fundamentally needed to stem the decline. This rural housing strategy is built on crumbling foundation. It's tacked to housing targets. The government's own risk register warns there may be a high risk of being missed altogether. And given the...
A couple of things just to pick up on, and I think that's key to give a bit of context. And Kenny Gibson touched it around about 40% more delivery per 100 houses, households than in England, but also 70% more than in Labour-controlled Wales. Coming back to the Empty Homes Partnership, I think I already mentioned that they produced a report and we're working very closely with them. But one of the key points, and this is what I wonder where Labour would support this, our budget is £3.5 billion. If I could increase that budget, if we had the authority from the UK government to increase that borrowing to £10 billion, we could move a lot quicker. Would Labour support that if we went to the UK government and asked for additional borrowing? Or if Labour won the next election, would they increase the borrowing powers of the Scottish government to allow us to build more homes?
Mark Griffin.
We'd absolutely support more capital spending on housing. And I come on to some of the policies that we've been suggesting in this chamber for years now that the SNP government are dragging their heels on. And the reason I talked about the numbers and the government's own risk register warning that there's a high risk that those targets might be missed is because the government's own house building programme is now defined by decline, with 2023 starts and approvals at their lowest point since 2015. We need a renewed commitment that these homes will be delivered and that rural communities need to know the government is focused on securing the homes for them. Labour's amendment today calls for the government to cement its ambition and to set an interim target of 5,500 rural homes being delivered by 2026. It's just not credible to say that we'll do it by 2032 when this government might be long out of office. It's just kicking the can down the road. But regardless, the government is proposing to undercut rural communities, which could in itself accelerate the depopulation this action plan is meant to tackle. As Rachel Hamilton and Finlay Carson point out, rural, remote and island communities comprise of 17% of Scotland's population. Now, in 2021-22, a sixth, and that's 16% of the affordable homes this government supported were built in rural communities. So why, when the government said that it delivered 10,000 rural homes since 2016, will it take almost a decade to deliver almost the same number? Now, from the Minister's own contribution, it seems that this 10% target is just a figure plucked out there so that the government can say we hit our target, when in fact they've performed better than that in 21-22 and in the last 7 years. It seems like it's just an easy target to hit, paying lip service to our rural communities rather than delivering that real ambition that they deserve and need. And there is more. There is more that can be done to raise funds directly for rural housing and give these communities a chance to grow and succeed. I recently met with Salmon Scotland, and not to talk about salmon, but to hear about how badly wrong the basics of the housing market are. And the lack of affordable housing is stopping the Highlands and Islands becoming a northern economic powerhouse, with workers unable to live near their work, their families, causing depopulation. And if we ever needed an example of how something so bad for business, jobs, growth and the economy is, it's the housing crisis that we're experiencing in rural Scotland. I will.
Minister.
Yeah, and I also met with Salmon Scotland, and there are discussions ongoing around about that and about the proposals that they put forward that Mark Griffin knows about. I think they met us on the same day. I remember having that discussion. In terms of, I fully recognise, and obviously, you know, seen the amendment, but I fully recognise the importance of housing and the role it plays in economic development. I mentioned about the visit to Nigan and Bergordon, and obviously met employers up there about what we can do to work more closely in that regard. So, of course, there's that contact, and we will continue. The Key Workers Fund is something that we're encouraging local authorities to apply to. At the moment, there are some discussions, but we've not had any, you know, active conversations around about that or proposals coming forward. So it's, again, something that we're working with COSLAW on, and ask them to make sure the proposals come forward around about that particular fund.
Mark Griffin, I can give you the time back.
Yep. Well, it's good to hear the government are doing some thinking, because when I did ask the government, I'd submitted written questions about what government was doing with the estimated £20 million in additional funding the Crown Estate expects to raise from increased fees from fish fin tents. It does seem to have no plans, and that's an example, Presiding Officer, of a pot of funding that could be aiding rural house building. And so too would our amendment, which calls for a council tax escalator on long-term empty homes. Now, by giving councils powers to increase council tax each year a home is empty, we estimate it could raise up to £30 million. But better still, it could be that catalyst to help owners of empty homes, of which around 28,000 lie empty, to bring them back to the market so that these properties are lived in, their homes, they're valued again. And as the plan says, better using the stock that we've got, and I endorse the points made by Conservative speakers about the need to introduce compulsory sale and also compulsory rental orders to get those empty homes back in use. But the government's own recent consultation backed increasing the council tax on empty homes and a stepped approach. Again, another revenue stream the government have put to good use, but seem to be dragging their heels on when urgency is key. And while we welcome the government backing our call to give councils powers to apply a surcharge on second homes, had powers been introduced when the First Minister came out in support of those proposals, councils could have raised £35 million this financial year. Now, going back to the Minister's initial intervention, taken together as a part of a package that also could have abolished small business rates relief for short-term lets and powers for surcharges on empty homes and second homes, that is a package that could have raised £85 million per year. That is a substantial sum of money that could have gone towards addressing housing market failure that affects rural areas. The depopulation of rural areas should not be seen as the status quo, and economic prosperity at the front and centre of ensuring rural communities can survive and thrive. But, Presiding Officer, today has been a missed opportunity, and worse for us. We feel that this long-awaited Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan is desperately short on action, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Griffin. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton, around 6 minutes. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. It gives me great pleasure to speak to the Liberal Democrats in this debate. I'm grateful for the government for making time for it on this important subject. Presiding Officer, between this March and last March, construction began on just over 6,900 affordable homes. That represents a decrease of 15% on the previous year. Presiding officer, it is the lowest annual figure since 2015, before I was in Parliament. These disappointing figures come amidst what is undeniably a housing crisis in Scotland right now. It is a crisis which is well documented, we've heard about it today, and it is deeply felt across this country, but no more so in our remote, rural and our island communities. I see the impact of housing issues every day in my own West Edinburgh constituency. In fact, the bulk of my casework relates to that. That's why next week I'm convening a summit in Parliament on housing issues affecting those who live in the capital. But the learning points from that will have ramifications, I believe, for remote and rural communities as well. I will take an intervention from the Minister.
Minister.
An intervention. I think there's a couple of things to give us a piece of context. Completions were a 20-year high just recently. And, you know, going down, not just in rural housing, but as you know, going down to Edinburgh and other parts of the country as well, the biggest barrier at the moment to house building is the cost of borrowing and also in terms of construction inflation. So that's the biggest barrier. Going down, speaking to housing associations, speaking to developers, speaking to Homes for Scotland, the cost of borrowing, where interest rates are and construction inflation, is the biggest barrier that we face. We can't do anything about that because we don't have the powers here to do that.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I hope I can get some of that time back. I mean, the Minister's not wrong. The cost of borrowing has increased, but there's still a competitive development market out there. And indeed, in my own constituency, there are many applications that come in all of the time. It's just where developers choose to put their investment rather than where the need is greatest. And we need to reset and recalibrate that very urgently. But as I said, Presiding Officer, there are serious issues right now across the country, and we have accumulated a shortfall of 114,000 homes built since 2008, since before the credit crunch, before the cost of living emergency and the increase in interest rates to which the Minister alludes. And nowhere can this shortage be more felt more acutely than in our rural and our island communities. There it is leading to extreme pressures in affordability, and the figures bear this out. Over 8,500 new homes were delivered in 2007. By 2022, that number had fallen to 6,500. That is 24% of a fall. Some local authorities have it even worse than others. This is a postcode lottery. Shetland has seen a 39% decline, and new housing in the Borders has declined to a staggering 65% shortfall. Our rural and island communities are further suffering from a lack of new, high-quality, energy-efficient homes, which is impacting on their long-term sustainability and their marketability. While I am grateful to see the government finally giving this the attention it so desperately needs with the publication of the Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan, which we're discussing today, I am concerned by a lack of focus when it comes to the quality of that housing. One issue we'd like to see, Liberal Democrats would like to see given more attention to, is fuel poverty, which is an issue that has an outsized impact on rural and island communities, but only gets the very briefest of mentions in relation to the existing housing stock. Fuel poverty is indeed a major issue. It exacerbates poverty and stretches tight incomes. Apart from the lack of rural and island housing, which threatens depopulation and the viability of those communities, fuel poverty is perhaps the most persistent and pernicious issue when it comes to discussing rural and island housing. The latest data we have at a local authority level show that our rural and island communities consistently top the list for fuel poverty, sitting way above the national average. Orkney, your own constituency, and Shetland, both at 31%. Argyll and Bute, 32%. Highland, 33%. And the Western Isles at a whopping 40% of homes in fuel poverty. These figures are not even up to date, though. They're from 2019, and the Scottish Government doesn't actually know how many people in our rural island areas are currently fuel poor. But if national modelling released earlier this year is anything to go by, coupled with the cost of living emergency and the energy crisis, these figures will only be far higher. In the 21st century, it should go without saying that heating your home should not cause or exacerbate poverty. Scottish Liberal Democrats, therefore, want to see a programme of Scottish Government support for emergency home insulation that would reduce energy costs by improving efficiency and have a positive impact on our climate targets and objectives towards the climate emergency in the process. We also want to see a new... If I have time?
I can give you the time back.
Thank you. I'll
Minister,
take
Minister, could you put, Minister, could you put your microphone up a bit?
Sorry.
Thanks very much.
Sorry, just to address that point, I think that's a really important point. Each local authority will need to be producing its health strategy by the end of the year, which will include the authorities that you mentioned. And I'm working very closely with Patrick Harvey on that particular issue and with the other local authorities. It is an incredibly important issue that I am very cognizant of. So just to give them that reassurance, it's not something that's been forgotten about in the action plan. It's a much broader subject than just the Rural Housing Action Plan itself. But to give them reassurance, that is a not
thank Mr. Cole Hamilton, and give you the time back for both interventions.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, I'm grateful for the intervention. I also take the Minister's remarks in good faith. That said, his predecessors have not measured up to the task. And you know, this government has been in charge for 16 years now. We have not seen movement to the extent we need it to address remote and rural fuel poverty through these mitigation measures in all that time. And I think it's high time we took it seriously. I'm glad to hear the rhetoric coming from the Minister today. It now needs to be met with action. We also want to see a new substantial Scottish housing standard. That means a proper Scottish equivalent to the passive house model standard for environmentally friendly buildings and climate friendly materials and design. But this government must listen to the concerns that have been raised and ensure that the standard does not impede efforts to build the number of houses we desperately need. My colleague Willie Rennie has met with Donaldson Group in Fife to discuss their work on a standard which uses lower carbon materials and leads to lower running costs than the original passive house standard. And I encourage the government to look at that work in detail. It goes without saying that as we tackle this crisis, it is absolutely critical we do so in a sustainable and environmentally coherent way by building homes that will remain affordable, which are designed and built to last. And Presiding Officer, we need to consistently highlight the negative impact that planning delays are having on housing delivery as well. Delays to planning often result in increased costs and fewer housing sites being opened altogether. Last year, the average processing time for major housing applications was over 42 weeks. And let's not forget, the statutory target is just 16. That is nowhere near good enough, and it is getting in the way. If the government is to take meaningful action on rural and island developments, we need to improve that now. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole Hamilton. We now move to the open debate. I call first Ivan McKee to be followed by Jamie Hawker-Johnson, around 6 minutes. Mr. McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And in the interest of transparency, just draw the Chamber's attention to my declaration of interest with regards to ownership of private rented properties. Presiding Officer, delighted to speak in this debate this afternoon on the importance of housing supply for rural and island communities, not least because of the criticality of housing supply to Scotland realising our economic ambitions, because we can't grow the economy without people and we can't grow the population without houses, nor indeed our tax base. In Scotland's rural economy, performing at its potential is necessary to deliver the full potential of Scotland's economy, be it as a whole, be it in our tourism sector, renewable energy, food and drink, aquaculture, fishing, or indeed our rapidly growing and potentially world-leading space sector. So for all of those reasons, the supply of housing stock is absolutely critical, not just for the social impact, but very much also for the economic impact, particularly in rural and island communities, but this is absolutely true right across the whole country. That's why, yes, indeed, can I get there? Thank you.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank Ivan McKee for taking the intervention. But Ivan McKee agree with me that certainly when it comes to any proposals, that certainly those set of proposals have to be the right proposals for the right location.
Ivan McKee.
That's absolutely true. Scotland is wide and varied in many locations, and each of them will have a different emphasis and focus on what is required to tackle this problem. So I welcome the Rural and Island Housing Action Plan. But as I say, much of what it brings forward applies right across the country. One point I would make is that there's a focus on affordable housing, but I very much believe that needs to be a broader focus right across all tenures. The only sustainable way to keep housing affordable is to have a significant build, as I say, across all tenures and not in what is traditionally defined as affordable housing, because that helps to keep all prices affordable if the supply is there to meet or exceed the demand. As I said, the economy needs people, and Scotland has had success in attracting talent from the rest of the UK. We are an attractive location to come and live and work. And it's the Scottish Government has been very clear that we want to see more inward migration into Scotland and argue for powers to do that. But we need to face up to the reality, even if we had those powers at the moment, we would struggle to house everyone that may want to come and live and work here. So I think I would ask the government to be ambitious, to get ahead of the curve and make sure that that supply is ahead of not just current demand, but potential future demand, absolutely critical to our population and economy ambitions. It's good to hear the Minister in that regard having discussions with the SFE and investors on expanding investment, particularly into build-to-rent, and I'd be interested to know how much of that potential lies in rural areas. In terms of the action plan itself, it's welcome to see the focus on identifying land for housing in the context of MPF4 and the work on taking forward land reform legislation to increase transparency round about ownership, and also the work that's happening to look at public sector estate and understand how much of that can be brought forward to address local housing needs. Local housing assessments is important to improve understanding of housing requirements, but again, I would say get ahead of the curve. Population trends can be driven by policy. It's not just a question of responding to them, be that Scotland's population as a whole or indeed the drift west to east or from rural to urban. The focus on local economies is hugely important, and it's good to see effective engagement with local employers. But I would also say that working with inward investors, potential inward investors, to align housing supply with skill supply with that potential inward investment into those key rural and island sectors is hugely important as well. And I know employers are very much up for that conversation. The work that's identified in the plan on addressing skills and capacity in supply chains, particularly small and medium-sized builders in the rural economy, is absolutely critical. Modern methods of construction are mentioned. I'm delighted to see that working closely, I hope, with Scotland's Construction Innovation Centre, BEST. And also, I would urge the Minister to make sure we have a very thorough look at the potential for off-site build, factory build units that could be dropped into place, helping tackle those labour shortages in rural areas, at least initially. The focus on bringing more empty homes into use, or indeed second homes into residential use, is hugely welcome. I would ask the Minister the question. It's good to see the 100% premium being brought forward on second home council tax, but why have a cap on that at all, and why not just leave it to local authorities to decide how high that premium should be to suit local circumstances. The work on compulsory purchase orders, glad to see that, and again, that alongside work potentially on compulsory sales orders, which again has an urban as well as a rural applicability, making that process clearer, fairer and faster, as the action plan defines. Planning times has been discussed already, and the fact that for major projects, that time lag is 42, 43 weeks versus a 16-week statutory time frame. And even for smaller projects, it can be a 14 weeks versus a 12-week statutory time frame. That is something that absolutely needs to be addressed. I know the Minister understands that, but I'd be interested to know what work has been taken forward there to address those excessive times.
Mr McGee's just winding up.
Okay, yes, I am indeed. And just to finish off, Presiding Officer, the point on permitted development rights that my colleague Fergus Ewan raised to enable farmers and others to build small numbers of houses on land where that is required, I think is something that absolutely needs to be looked at. And finally, I'd like to ask the Minister if work on other tax levers. Land value tax, capturing the land value uplift is going to be considered in the land reform bill coming forward. Progressively broadening out that tax base and ensuring communities benefit from the uplift in land value and also increasing the scope for delivering more homes as a consequence. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr McKee. I now call Jamie Halker-Johnson to be followed by Kenneth Gibson, around 6 minutes. Mr Halker-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I firstly refer members to my register of interest as the owner of a croft, as a partner in a farming partnership which owns a rental property, and as a member of both NFUS and Scottish Land and Estates. This is an extremely important subject for my Highlands and Islands region and for rural and island Scotland more generally. I welcome today's debate. Housing and the lack of availability of it is an issue which I think we can all agree impacts on those we represent, our local economies, and on the delivery of local public services. So I give a very cautious welcome to the Scottish Government's Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan, and I do so because I would question as the amendment in the name of my colleague Rachel Hamilton does, how ambitious it really is. It makes promises on delivering new affordable homes, but as Finlay Carson rightly highlighted, says only 10% will be built in the rural and island areas where 17% of Scotland's population actually live. And one might ask, as many of my constituents do, with housing concern regularly raised with me, why this new plan, coming as it does after 16 years of this SNP government, will be any more successful than the previous efforts. Or is it just SNP ministers finally recognising the seriousness of the situation and the failure of those previous efforts to rectify it? Presiding officer, when the Scottish Government announced 30 million would be made available for the Rural Housing and Island Housing Funds, originally planned to run from 2016-17 to 2021, they suggested the funds would help them hit their 50,000 affordable homes target. Well, they missed that target. And when questioned by my colleague Miles Briggs, the Scottish Government claimed the Rural and Island Housing Funds play an important role in offering support to community organisations and others to deliver affordable homes. And yet, because of poor uptake, the application period for both funds had to be extended and they were still being allocated in 2022-23. And despite that extension, between 2016-17 and 2022-23, the Scottish Government had spent less than 18 million of that combined £30 million funding pot. Surely, with what I hope the Minister will accept is serious pressures on housing availability in our rural and island areas, the lack of uptake of these funds clearly demonstrates that there were issues with how those funds were delivered. In 2018-19, 2 years into the scheme, they funded only one property in the whole of Scotland. In 2020-21, the last year the schemes were originally intended to run, they funded only 20 properties. That's despite millions of pounds of available funding still sitting in Scottish Government coffers in Edinburgh, where it should have been being used to deliver much-needed homes in rural and island communities. I will actually take an intervention, and so I would ask the Minister, and I'm happy to take an intervention from him to answer these points. What went wrong with the Rural Housing and Island Housing Funds? What lessons have the Scottish Government learned to ensure those mistakes, whether they were eligibility issues, lack of awareness of the schemes, won't be made again with any new schemes? Is the £45 million the Scottish Government has claimed will be allocated to the new Remote Rural and Island Housing Fund all new funding, or will it include reallocation of unspent funds from the existing Rural Housing and Island Housing Funds? And finally, why should we have any more confidence in any new schemes delivering the homes that are needed when the old one clearly didn't?
Minister.
Happy to pick up the points that Mr Harcourt-Johnson mentioned, and I'll come back and write to you on these specific points if you can come back. In general, I can't comment on the past. The funding was always there. One of the key things are going around about Highland 2. One was around about infrastructure, and I think that's incredibly important about what we need to do, look around about how we can look at infrastructure to bring housing forward. I was up in Shetland, for example, and we provided £30 million infrastructure funding, which will deliver 300 homes in Shetland, which will make a real difference. So it's getting down to that level of detail around about that. So it's looking in the context. The issue wasn't the funding, it was around about working with local authorities. And one of the key things, I think, for myself in terms of this as well, is how do we link economic development and broader economic development opportunities to housing and around about that as well. So in discussion with employers and local authorities, I think that's a key point kind of going forward. But happy to address the points, the more specific points, if we can write to him on these matters.
Jamie Harcourt-Jones.
Well, I'm grateful for that. I think the Minister said he can't comment on things of the past, but surely to make sure that we've got proposals that work going forward, we have to be commenting, learning, listening and finding out what went wrong. Presiding officer, the SNP has had 16 years to get this right and they failed. On their party website, they still boast that the funding will help young people and families to stay or make their lives in rural, remote and island communities. But in a survey conducted by Ipsos for Highlands and Islands Enterprise, nearly half of the young people in the Highlands and Islands questioned said they plan to move away from the area in the next 5 years, with 76% saying there aren't enough affordable homes to rent or buy. I would genuinely love to believe that. Finally, belatedly, although many years too late, the SNP had recognised the need for action. But I can't. This still doesn't feel like a revolutionary new approach to deliver what they failed to deliver for so long. It feels like more of the same, but it's a revolution what is needed. That's why the Scottish Conservatives would create a Scottish Housing Delivery Agency to work with local authorities and house and developers to deliver and build new houses. Why we would allow permitted development for rural homes, giving more freedom to farms or other businesses to play their part in addressing rural and island housing shortages as well as helping accommodate workers. And I'm glad that it sounds like we've got some support from the SNP backbenchers for that. Presiding officer, as Mark Griffin highlighted, employers like Scottish Salmon have said, the lack of affordable housing is stopping my Highlands and Islands region from becoming a powerhouse. Scottish Land and Estates has said that the SNP's Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan is not ambitious or radical enough to deliver the step change needed to meet rural housing needs. Housing charity Shelter said it does not indicate the government recognises the severity of the situation. Getting housing right is vital for my region, but not enough homes are being built. And that lack of housing, both in the public and private sectors, seriously impacts on the delivery of public services, on the ability of local businesses to thrive, and on people to stay in the communities they were brought up in. A lack of homes threatens the very future of some of our most fragile communities. Our rural and island communities can't afford the SNP to get this wrong again.
The Minister, the Member's winding up. The Member has wound up. Thank you, Mr. Hawker-Johnson. I now call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Colin Smith, around 6 minutes, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I draw members' attention to my register of interest as someone who rents out a property, albeit not in rural or island Scotland. I welcome the publication of this action plan and the dedicated support being provided to tackle the lack of affordable housing in rural and island areas. I've no doubt that my Arran and Cumbria constituents and the businesses operating those islands will welcome it too. In 2021, 18 affordable, energy-efficient council homes were built on Cumbria, supported by a Scottish Government grant of £1.32 million, and a mix of 34 general needs, amenity bungalows and accessible council houses were built in Arran last year, backed by a £2.38 million grant, which is £70,000 a council house, or 3.5 times the grant that's available for council housing in England. Now, this is in stark contrast to the mere 6 council houses built by the last Labour Lib Dem administration over 4 years across all of Scotland. And despite the financial crash, Tory austerity and the pandemic, in the last financial year alone, 1,947 council homes were completed across Scotland, as ministers strive to ensure everyone has a warm, safe and affordable home. But of course, despite the Scottish Government's ambitious targets, it's evident that rural and island communities have experienced economic hardship, particularly due to the difficulty in economically active people being able to afford island housing costs. Community-led housing projects such as Arran Development Trust River Den Affordable Housing Project, the biggest such housing project in Scotland's islands, is playing a key role in increasing the availability of affordable housing and in turn the prospects of islanders. Thanks to a record £1.512 million from the Scottish Government's Rural and Island Housing Fund, £84,000 for each new home, 18 one, two and three-bedroom homes are now under construction in Lumlash, backed by the provision of 24 further affordable building plots on Arran. This project is an excellent example of a positive outcome created by collaborative working between the public and private sectors and the community. I trust that Arran Development Trust and the Islanders' bold ambitions and dedication can be learned from to ensure that local communities' voices are heard within planning processes throughout Scotland. The continued support offered by civil servants throughout this project was greatly appreciated, with the announcement of the project in May being very warmly welcomed. However, it took some 3 years to secure a grant from the Rural and Islands Housing Fund, and I urge the Minister to explore how such projects can be expedited in future, and can be long and weary for organisations like Arran Development Trust, of mostly volunteers, to deliver such projects and attend to those who lack their dogged determination and patience. The First Minister's visit to Arran on 23rd of August, where he met with Arran Development Trust to discuss the demand for affordable housing, the cost of building on islands and empowerment for island communities, ensure that islanders know that their lived experiences are valued when implementing housing policy. The Trust appreciated the opportunity to relay their concerns directly to the First Minister, with a number of the points raised reflected in the plan. Arran's largest employer, Achrane Resort, has been vocal about how a lack of affordable island housing has impacted their business, with many employees unable to reside in the island in a home of their own. Achrane is an employer-owned business and should be commended with providing 103 accommodation units to team members, removing the need to commute while supporting those residing on the island. However, understandably, employees don't see such accommodation as a home, leading to few retaining their employment for long, and its provision means that the true level of homelessness is regrettably underestimated. Team accommodation should not be included in figures of people's housed if we are to actually reflect need. The programme for government dedicated up to £25 million to identifying homes for key workers in rural communities, and this funding is essential to ensure businesses within rural and island communities remain afloat, particularly after the devastating impact of the pandemic. And I welcome the Island Skills and Repopulation Pilot, with one of the three projects taking place on Arran in Cumbria. Through supporting career pathways, retraining and upskilling, local economies of the two islands in my constituency will diversify, increasing capacity and skills across a variety of sectors, further supporting the delivery of more affordable housing. I look forward to the publication of the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan this autumn, and will continue to work with the Minister and Island communities to tackle depopulation, which is essential if we are to ensure islanders don't have to move to the mainland for housing. North Ayrshire's first of its kind in Scotland community wealth building approach to economic development offers a unique opportunity to contribute to our well-being economy, as well as the local authority's five pillars whilst building affordable homes. By using local procurement, we can deliver more and better jobs, business growth and shorter supply chains, creating greater resilience whilst also supporting net zero ambitions. And in turn, this boost to the local economy increases opportunities to build more affordable homes. As many island and rural communities experience, across Arran, 26% of the housing stock are either second or empty homes, 735 properties, with 47% in one village. Whilst not the primary cause of the island's lack of affordable housing, these homes could play a role in the solution. Whilst Arran's economy is heavily dependent upon tourism, it's essential that employees supporting community services remain on the island, one key need being permanent and affordable housing. It's essential we encourage empty and second homes into long-term rent across construction of affordable homes. Arran Development Trust have long campaigned for councils to be granted more discretion over the rates of council tax on second homes, and will welcome the secondary legislation to be delivered by the Scottish Government, enabling local authorities to apply up to 100% premium on council tax rates for second homes from April next year. Compulsory sales orders can also play an important role, and I urge the Minister to take this forward, as other members across the Chamber have urged. Presiding Officer, the Rural and Island Housing Action Plan, if and when implemented, should successfully tackle a number of issues contributing to Arran and Cumbria's affordable housing crisis and that in other islands. I welcome the Minister's innovative approach to ensure island and rural communities will have increased access to affordable homes, helping boost local economies, and I welcome the Minister promise to visit my constituency and meet directly with Arran Development Trust and stakeholders affected by the prevalence of second and empty homes to ensure housing policy alleviates the burden on elders in my constituency.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. I now call Colin Smith to be followed by Emma Harper. Around 6 minutes, Mr Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In February this year, the South of Scotland Convention held its biannual gathering, bringing together government ministers and key national and local public bodies with responsibility for growth. The convention usually debates a range of economic issues. This time there was just one item on the agenda, housing, such as the crisis facing the region. South of Scotland Enterprise have described that crisis, that lack of affordable housing, as one of the biggest economic barriers facing the region. A week really goes past when I don't speak to a business facing labour shortages, struggling to recruit, but more and more of those businesses are telling me that even when potential employees are interested in taking up posts, often they can't because there's no suitable affordable housing near the place of work. I've spoken to hospitality businesses who've bought nearby hotels just to house their own workers because it's the only way they could attract key staff such as chefs. That lack of housing is holding back the local economy, it's stifling growth and it's blocking the ambitions of those who want to get on. We're simply not building enough affordable homes to meet demand and meet the needs of our rural communities. That's partly because of house building capacity. National house builders have little interest in building what they view as small-scale developments in rural areas, and we've seen a decline in the number of locally based house builders. Those that do exist are increasingly facing skill shortages of their own and can't get local contractors. Yet, astonishingly, government cuts recently meant Skills Development Scotland reduced the apprenticeship contract for Dumfries and Galloway College by 13%. At a time when demand for apprentices is at peak levels, we now have a waiting list at the college for apprenticeship places in construction. The government has also taken its eye off the ball when it comes to making best use of existing housing. Many of the properties in the region are old, with poor energy efficiency and eye-watering levels of fuel poverty, higher than the national average, in fact, almost a third of households. Too many families are also being priced out of the area due to the acquisition of second homes that often sit empty for much of the year. I'll take it in attention.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does Labour and Colin Smith agree with expanding permitted development rights to ensure that we do have enough housing for people that are struggling to stay and live and work in their own areas?
Colin Smith.
I absolutely believe we need a far more can-do approach to our planning processes. One move that would help would be to properly resource planning authorities to make decisions as quickly as possible, because we've seen the delays rise in recent years. Now, at a time of all these challenges, we've seen an increase of over 90% in the number of open homelessness cases in Dumfries and Galloway compared to 2019-20, with the number of children in temporary accommodation rising by two-thirds alone in just 1 year in the region. The crisis is so bad that housing officers are placing people in caravans and in 50 bed and breakfasts across the region. Yet the number of homes in Dumfries and Galloway that were given grant funding by the Scottish Government in the year to the end of June as part of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme was down by 22%. The number of affordable homes started in the region is at its lowest level since 2016. It's little wonder that, despite the many admirable aims, the universal response to the Government's Rural Housing Action Plan is that there simply isn't enough action. The Scottish Federation of Housing Associations says the plan does not go far enough. Scotland Land and Estate say it's not ambitious or radical enough to deliver the step change needed to meet rural housing needs. Home for Scotland say the plan does little to identify the challenges home builders face. And Shelter Scotland say the plan does not indicate the government recognises the severity of the situation. A housing emergency needs an emergency response, they say. You can see the lack of that emergency response, that lack of ambition in the government's motion today, not least with that target of 10% of the planned affordable homes being in rural and island areas, when the government's own figures show the population of rural Scotland is 17%. The minister seems to suggest today that that figure of 10% is just plucked out of the air. So, Presiding Officer, we need far more action in the government's so-called action plan. That means more urgent targets when it comes to building of new homes in rural areas. And as Mark Griffin has set out, Labour is also supporting not only a 100% council tax surcharge on second homes, but wants to see local authorities given powers to introduce an escalating council tax surcharge on empty homes, a call that was supported in the responses to the Scottish Government's own consultation on council tax for second and empty homes. A 100% second home surcharge would raise £1.8 million alone in Dumfries and Galloway, and an empty home escalator a further £1 million, money that could be used to bring more empty properties back into use. To kickstart house building, we also need a more can-do approach from our planning and consenting processes for new housing that's rural-specific, and we need an allocation of resources that properly reflects the often additional cost of housing in rural areas, in particular when it comes to the cost of renovation and energy efficiency measures in older properties. Presiding Officer, I recognise there is good practice in rural housing. I see for myself the work, for example, of South of Scotland Community Housing through developments such as the old police station in Langham, refurbished to create affordable homes. But we need a lot more. A decent, warm, affordable home is a basic human right everyone, whoever they are, wherever they live, is entitled to. But for far too many of my constituents, that is a right that they are being denied. And until we have that emergency response from government to our housing crisis called for by Shelter, the ambitions of far too many families and the economies of rural Scotland will continue to be held back.
Thank you, Mr Smith. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Around 6 minutes, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Rural and Island Action Plan contains a wide range of examples of how rural and island housing has been created and delivered, and this diverse and innovative approach should be welcomed. Presiding Officer, today I want to focus my contribution on the unique rural housing challenges experienced in communities across Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish Borders. We have many opportunities to make a difference in improving rural housing and encouraging people to move to our rural areas to address depopulation and to keep our rural communities alive and thriving. Such possibilities include the need to incentivise housing development on brownfield, vacant, abandoned and derelict sites and to explore alternatives including accessible housing and acceptable types of housing to meet the needs of our areas. Marie Curie's briefing ahead of this debate was useful in highlighting that accessible housing and adaptations to housing need to be made more quickly, especially for our terminally ill people. And I thank Marie Curie for their briefing ahead of the debate. And Mark Griffin, he spoke about population decline, and that is a real threat to the sustainability of many of Scotland's rural communities, and the lack of good quality and affordable housing is a key concern. It is crucial that we acknowledge that the Scottish Government alone cannot tackle the critical challenges of depopulation, and national and I will in a wee minute, national and local government and the third and community and private sectors, they all have a role to play if we're to tackle depopulation collectively. I'll give way to Finlay Carson.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the member for giving way. You know, Colin Smith mentioned the Convention of the South of Scotland having simply housing on the agenda. When we promoted the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency, Colin Smith also brought forward an amendment to promote the development of affordable housing to be on the face of the bill. Why did Emma Harper vote against that?
Yeah. Emma Harper, I can give you the time back.
Thanks, Presiding Officer, for giving me time back. I'm coming to that, Mr Carson, actually, because I think it's crucial that when we're looking at what we need to do for housing, it's key that we look at how we're going to tackle depopulation. And this depopulation restricts the local labour supply and affects public service provision, as funding is typically population-driven. These were the reasons raised at a meeting that I attended with the Equalities and Depopulation Minister in Dumfries towards the end of the summer recess. And I welcome that the Scottish Government recognises the key role played by housing in supporting the successful delivery of its aims relating to addressing depopulation and wider population sustainability. However, in Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish Borders, in order to attract more people of working age, address depopulation, have good quality rural housing, while ensuring Scotland's food security, we do need to think innovatively. Presiding Officer, there is a wealth of evidence and research, including from the Scottish Land Commission, which demonstrates that changes to VAT in construction, which is currently at 5%, and we know that VAT is reserved to Westminster, but if we change the VAT percentage, it could help to address rural housing challenges. The evidence shows that if VAT was reformed, we could renew and regenerate and rebuild some of these vacant, abandoned and derelict sites and instead of using prime agricultural land, for instance. And we could use these vacant, abandoned, derelict sites, which are a blight to our communities, and we could be changing these sites if VAT was reduced. And it also ensures our productive agricultural land is protected for national... I will take an intervention from the Minister.
Yeah, Minister, briefly.
Just on that specific point, and I'll be very quick, in the discussions I've had, obviously, with construction companies and developers over that period of time, the VAT figure has been mentioned.
Minister, could you address the front to the microphone?
And that 5%, I think, can be the difference between some projects going ahead or not. So it's certainly an issue I will pick up with Emma Harper after this and raise with the UK Government.
Emma Harper.
Well, that's good news to hear that, Minister, that I know that it's something that has been raised in the Chamber before when we've talked about vacant, abandoned, derelict land and what we can do about it. And we know that Dumfries and Galloway and the Borders have more than their fair share of derelict sites. The former Interfloor factory in Dumfries, the George Hotel in Stranraer, the Central Hotel in Annan, the Mercury Hotel at Moffat, to name a few, and there's the NPL in Hawick and the Glenmark building in Hawick as well. And we know that published research from the Glasgow Centre of Population Health shows that neglected environments can contribute to mental ill health. So dilapidated neighbourhoods and abandoned shops or houses can make people feel unsafe, with rundown environments found to contribute to anxiety and persistent low mood. So I thank the Minister again for willing to speak to me about this issue of VAT so that we can encourage brownfield site redevelopment. One additional point, Presiding Officer, is our legacy of out-migration and depopulation combined with the challenges of Brexit and demographic change. It means that Scotland urgently needs the powers to increase inward migration. Scotland needs a tailored migration solution to tackle depopulation. That's why the Scottish Government has called for cross-party support for a rural visa pilot scheme. And the needs of Scotland are clearly not being met within the current UK government immigration system. So that's something that I think we need to keep pursuing. So I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer, and I think one thing I would like to ask the Minister is to explore an innovative company called Iron and Pine, based in Dalbeattie, who are able to make bespoke types of builds for whether it's palliative care beds, whether it's accommodation for rural employees that might be coming just for training, but also that can be used for long-term housing as well. So I'll close there, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Alistair Allen. Around 6 minutes, Ms Burgess.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to participate in this debate. As an MSP for the Highlands and Islands, I frequently discuss the pressing need for housing solutions with stakeholders across the region. Producing the plan was a commitment made in the Bute House Agreement, along with ensuring continued funding through the Rural and Island Housing Fund. With precarious populations and a lack of housing for key workers, this plan provides welcome momentum and direction in tackling our rural and island housing crisis. But the plan needs profile and priority to see it through. How will this plan boost the Community Empowerment Act, encourage asset transfers, and enable delivery of our islands plan? There must be policy coherence to support our communities and businesses working to deliver housing and placemaking. This plan can and must drive the delivery of rural and island housing, and the role of government is to support our communities in delivering the right homes in the right places, developing more high-quality, affordable homes, making the best use of existing homes, and supporting a range of ownership and tenures. Along with policy coherence, the success of this plan will be in the detail, and this is especially true when it comes to community-led housing. This plan comes on the back of the recently announced Bute House commitment to fund our rural housing enablers so that in turn they can build capacity, capability and confidence in communities to take their urgent housing needs into their own hands. Supporting communities is necessary if we are to meet the initial commitment of 11,000 rural homes. However, two things here. We need to acknowledge that community-led development happens on the backs of volunteer-led organisations, and what I'm hearing is that this is a challenge. We must find a way to support these organisations and secure funding, and with secure funding for community development officers. The other point is about the amount of housing. We must recognise that 11,000 houses is not the end. There is a need for more rural and island housing if we are to transform the future of our rural communities and see them thrive. We need to find better ways to assess the value and impact of building rural homes that captures the cultural, environmental and social benefits to communities so that we can tackle our rural and island population crisis. The plan is very welcome, but it needs to have all key stakeholders, especially the Scottish Government teams and local authorities, all bought into it and working together. We need to move away from some of the familiar approaches to housing options and build flexibility into the mix to respond to nuanced needs on the ground. For community-led development to work, communities must be seen as full project partners. This would mean communities getting involved in the very early stages of development, or if they take the lead, that the support from all levels of government is there and the barriers removed. I'd like to see more work being done to see how the Rural and Island Housing Fund can be opened up to support the growing demand for co-housing, which is a placemaking model that has a lot to offer in terms of well-being by tackling isolation and loneliness. While it's good to see that the Minister for Housing has been in discussion with the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands, this is a much broader issue, and I would like to see communication and collaboration taking place across a wider range of portfolios to drill down to community needs. For example, the need for carers in our rural communities means engaging with the health and social care sector as much as housing and rural affairs teams. In terms of building the housing, I welcome the commitment to do more with modern methods of construction. And it would be good to see the Scottish Government engaging with the numerous small companies based in my region, including Macker and North Woods, who have a track record of successful off-site construction and have a lot of experience to offer. When I talk to small construction companies, they tell me a challenge they face is being able to keep the cost of construction down. They don't have sufficient cash flow to support the purchase of large quantities of materials. And in some cases, these materials, like oriented strand board, OSB, are being manufactured right on their doorstep. And this is why I'm fully behind the approach being proposed by Communities Housing Trust to establish a materials hub so we can be building at scale but spread across the area. The idea being that materials can be purchased in bulk by the customer and made available to local construction companies. This approach also has the potential to bring confidence to the small-scale construction sector and support them to develop their apprenticeship program. If we're going to build 11,000 houses and more and take forward a place-making agenda, we not only need communities to lead, but we need buy-in from the people who are going to build it. Presiding Officer, this investment plan should be an opportunity to ensure that there are more people in all our communities with hands-on skills to maintain and repair local buildings. These skills are relevant to maintenance and retrofitting programs as they are to building schemes. Let's plan to preserve and maintain as well as build our communities. To conclude, we must do all that we can to ensure that there are homes for everyone who wants to live in the community, from young to old, families to single people. We must be taking the approach, like the calls for 1,000 homes in Highland, that will see lights going on in the Straths once again.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. I now call Alistair Allen to be followed by Finlay Carson, around 6 minutes. Dr Allen.
Presiding Officer, as the motion indicates, the Scottish Government is taking much vital action to address the housing crisis which now exists in many parts of the Highlands and Islands, not least through some serious investment in social housing. And indeed, any debate around the issue must begin with that frank admission that for young people in some rural communities, crisis is the only word that can be used. Decades-long trends on depopulation have accelerated since the pandemic. Island house prices have increased far more substantially than island wages. Those on the bottom rungs of the housing ladder simply lack the economic means even to begin to compete with retirees, property investors and second home purchasers. Presiding Officer, no government can build houses at the rate that they are disappearing in these ways. And for my own constituency in Hayland and Annear, between 2018 and 2028, the working age population is due to decrease by 6% and the number of children is due to decrease by 13%. At the same time, I regret to say the islands are also being touted in the national press as an idyllic wilderness, the best place in the UK for people to retire to. This definitely does not help. We are already seeing the impacts of all this on businesses and public services as critical vacancies go unfilled. In many communities, the balance is shifting rapidly away from year-round lived-in houses to short-term lets and second homes. When that trend gets out of hand in any community, the school closes, families relocate, and in the space of a generation or less, a village has transformed into a retirement or holiday community. Under those sorts of pressures is, of course, the Gaelic language being squeezed. Writing in The Observer earlier this month, Ness-born poet Donald S. Murray warns of the dangers involved in allowing an idea to take hold that the islands are merely a place where the natural world has a greater appeal than the existences of the humans in their surroundings. Presiding Officer, I do not say all this lightly. I am an incomer myself, and the islands need new people. But they need a mix of new people. So getting the housing question right is now an existential concern for many of the communities which I represent. So I very much welcome the publication of the Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. The plan supports Scotland's long-term housing strategy to 2040 and will help bolster the commitment to deliver 110,000 affordable homes up to 2032 of which 70% will be for social rent. Now, in response to some of the accusations that have been thrown around in the course of this debate, I should say that in my own constituency, over 650 housing association properties have been built since the SNP came to power in 2007. That is a third, roughly, of the Hebridean Housing Partnership stock. The Scottish Government has made more than £43 million available for affordable housing in the islands over the term of this Parliament alone. And that money, of course, now needs to be spent and spent wisely. But it's not just about building homes. It's about keeping homes in the housing stock. Hundreds of island houses have slipped out of domestic usage as the number of short-term lets has exploded, and that number of short-term lets is nearly 2.5 times now what it was a decade ago. Short-term let licensing and control areas now give local authorities much-needed options to exercise controls on this in communities where those controls are needed. And in common with other areas, my constituency also has high levels of empty houses. So I welcome the plan's focus on building on the work that has happened across the country, much of which can be said to have been pioneered by Corian and Éireann Shear and its empty homes officer, Murdo MacLeod. With nearly a quarter of all second homes in Scotland in the Highlands and Islands, many across the region consider that the unregulated increase in second homes is helping to fuel the housing crisis. Giving councils the ability to levy additional charges on second homes will help tackle this problem while bringing them into line with the existing rules for long-term empty properties. I also believe, personally, that the Scottish Government should now consider granting powers to restrict the number of further second homes in any locality in which the supply of housing for full-time habitation is under pressure. I welcome the plan's recognition of crofting's vital role in maintaining the population of the Highlands and Islands, and its commitment to reviewing the Croft House grant scheme in search of improvements. The upcoming reform of crofting law should, in my view, look for ways to make it easier for affordable housing developments to progress on land under crofting tenure. This, I know, has been a struggle in the Western Isles, where land of that particular type of tenure accounts for the great majority of the land mass. There is also an urgent need to tackle what are increasingly becoming, in some cases, absurd prices for croft tenancies on the open market. Presiding Officer, to conclude, while there are no easy solutions to the housing crisis, the Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan lays the foundations for a range of actions that have the potential to make a real difference to providing the housing that island communities urgently need.
Thank you very much, Dr. Allen. I now call Finlay Carson to be followed by Fergus Ewing, around 6 minutes, Mr. Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I've often said, my constituency is the most beautiful in Scotland, and I still believe that. Living in small communities like Galloway does have its many attractions, but it does have its disadvantages, including a significant lack of quality affordable homes to ensure people can live and work in rural Scotland. For many years, there's been a notable lack of suitable homes in the south, and much of it is old housing stock with poor energy efficiency. We also know there is a shortage of skills in rural Scotland, especially in traditional trades like plumbing, joinery, electricians, and inevitably that leads to a limited number of locally based house builders. The lack of suitable housing is a huge factor in the recruitment challenges for employers, both public and private, and undoubtedly prevents Dumfries and Galloway from delivering on its considerable potential. We face a vicious circle with house prices in the south remaining below the national average, but it's equally important to recognise that at the same time we have a high price to income ratio as a result of our historic low wage economy. Essentially, that means that affordability for local people is a serious issue. The shortage of supply has also been a major problem in the local property market, and with a lack of new social housing and affordable homes being built, we're failing to meet a growing demand. It makes it almost impossible for local first-time buyers and those local workers on low incomes to get on the property ladder. But the likelihood of the increasing demand for affordable housing being met is questionable if the Scottish Government's Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan is anything to go by. It promises to deliver 110 affordable homes by 2032, but with only 10% going to rural and island communities. So let me repeat the facts, because they are worthy of being repeated. In terms of land area, urban Scotland accounts for something around 2.2% of Scotland, and rural areas account for 97.8%. And in terms of population, urban areas account for 83% and rural areas account for 17%. So it's typical of the Scottish Government. They actually thought we might cheer the fact that 10% was being committed for rural housing. Disappointing? Yes. Surprising? No. The likelihood of this number being built is also highly questionable, given the 16% year-on-year cut to the housing capital budget, equating to nearly £113 million. It's little wonder that both the Scottish Federation of Housing Association and CIH Scotland have heavily criticised the reduction in funding from £893 million to £721.6 million for the Affordable Supply Programme. The housing bodies who called for an increase in new home funding argue that the reduction does not fit with the government's focus to reduce poverty in Scotland. The National Director of CIH Scotland said, and I quote, "The budget for new affordable homes has been reduced by over £200 million in real terms, which makes the already challenging target of 110 affordable homes even more difficult." And Sally Thomas, the Chief Executive of the SFHA, said, and I again quote, "Social housing provides one of the greatest protections against poverty, and we are alarmed to see a cut to the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, which, coupled with continuing uncertainty over rent setting and inflationary pressures on cost, it seriously threatens our members' ability to build homes. A budget decrease of any amount will still reduce the number of homes our members can build, and we urge the government to rethink this cut if it is serious about tackling poverty in Scotland." I will.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank the member for taking the intervention and just ask the question, if he believes social housing is so important, why does he support the UK government cutting the capital budget for the Scottish government?
Finlay Carson.
It's so sad, and does you know service continually deflecting where we are. The block grant in Scotland increased, and it's about priorities. And yet, obviously, this SNP government don't prioritise rural areas and affordable housing. We do have the stark prospect of less homes being built, and this will do little to encourage our younger generation to remain close to home or indeed return home. Depopulation remains at crisis point. Young people want and deserve a future they can plan for, which is why many are having to consider moving to more urban areas to gain a decent wage, better prospects and, more importantly, a roof over their heads. Depopulation in rural Scotland was highlighted last year when the report, The Population Estimates for Settlements and Localities, revealed the growing movement towards larger towns and cities. Dr Callum MacLeod, the Policy Director at Community Land Scotland, said, The report starkly illustrates the depopulation and demographic crisis faced by many of Scotland's rural areas. We urgently need to repopulate these areas and also resettle previously inhabited rural places where it is practical to do so. Dr MacLeod continued, and I quote, "That requires tangible actions in the form of affordable houses, good quality jobs, better infrastructure and digital connectivity to fill the Scottish Government's commitment to increase the population of rural Scotland, which is contained in National Planning Framework 4. As mentioned earlier, those fortunate to have a home often encounter another major headache, and that's fuel poverty, with many rural properties off-grid relying on alternative heat solutions, many of which are costly and in some cases unsuitable. In its latest report, ChangeWorks Scotland's lead environmental charity highlights the inequity facing rural households, identifying several negative factors which, when combined, create a perfect storm of very significant fuel poverty across rural Scotland. The plight of Scottish households driven into fuel poverty is worsened by the lack of effective alleviation measures. And Chief Executive Lockhart said the report highlights the unjust reality that rural Scotland experiences higher levels of fuel poverty than the rest of the country. Presiding Officer, I've highlighted the stellar work carried out by the South of Scotland Community Housing Association previously in the Chamber. And until March 2020, the organisation was co-funded by the Scottish Government via More Homes. But this Scottish Government withdrew funding, despite the fact it provided long-term technical and professional support to community organisations and landowners around the planning and delivery of affordable homes that addresses local needs. Now, I'm pleased that the Ministers, for once, have taken on board my and others' calls to restore their funding. And albeit a U-turn, it's a small step in the right direction,
but not the giant leap that rural communities were hoping to see and need to see to survive.
Thank you very much, Mr Carson. I now call on Fergus Ewing, who is the final speaker in the open debate, after which we will move to closing speeches. Mr Ewing, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd start by referring to my declaration of interest. I own a small cottage in Lossiemouth, which for the last 16 years has been let on a long-term basis. Presiding Officer, this is not the first time I've made this speech in this session of Parliament, and I have a feeling it may not be the last occasion. When I made the points I'm going to make again today, the Minister was kind enough to suggest that I should write to him, setting out, fleshing out the detail. I was very happy to do that. I know the Minister has been very energetic in his portfolio, and I was keen to genuinely to try to influence the Scottish Government to take up some ideas which I have had and which have enjoyed fairly substantial support in rural Scotland, I believe. I did set these ideas out in a letter of 1st of September. It wasn't a short letter. I don't think I can lay any claim to any talent for brevity, Presiding Officer, in any way. So there we are, 6 pages of closely typed foolscap. I haven't yet received a reply, but what's really important, Minister, is that I do hope that you will do more than consider what I have to say today, because I'm saying this as somebody who spent 20 years as a lawyer working and conveyancing to a great extent, and then now 25 years as a rural an MSP for a constituency which is largely rural. And over that period, I've been fortunate to work very closely with land agents, with surveyors, with landowners, with farmers, with tenant farmers, with crofters, with local builders, with local artisans. And I think I've got, therefore, a sense of what we need to do in order to tackle a problem where we all agree that we need to do far, far better. And let me at the outset say that, you know, as Dr. Allen has argued, as Kenny Gibson has argued, you know, housing associations and local authorities do a great job in providing affordable and mid-rent housing. They're very professional. It's not easy. The complexities, delays are extremely difficult. The Minister, from his time in local government, is well aware of this. But what I want to do today is say that I think there is a danger of a missed opportunity in this document. It does make passing reference. I found two passing references, I think, to working with private landowners. But no more than that, and I couldn't see in any of the action points at the end, other than possibly on a medium-long-term basis, of correcting this. Now, when I say private landowners, I'm talking about a whole panoply, really. But landed estates, those who have particular land holdings, farmers, substantially farmers, crofters, including secured tenant farmers, incidentally. And I believe that this asset that we have of privately owned land is an asset which most owners really want to do everything they can to develop. They want to make a contribution to providing more housing in rural Scotland. And I believe our approach should be to assist them, and to assist them by working very closely with them. Indeed, nobody knows more about rural Scotland than people who have farmed or crofted the land in many cases for hundreds of years in their families. I met some farmers recently in the October recess just outside Nethy Bridge, and the knowledge of the local area is immense. The knowledge of how to do things is immense. The skills, they're usually not only just farmers, of course, they have many, many skills which they put to good use. So reach out to the Minister. I think this would be a standing committee, and I do think a number of specifics would help. First of all, I've suggested before, and I'll say again, that I think permitted development rights extended to building new homes of five houses per unit would be a terrific step forward. Now, this is supported, I believe, by the NFUS and SLE. I sent my letter to them. They've confirmed to me privately that they support it, and I see that in the SLE briefing today. This would do a tremendous lot to mobilise the sleeping capital held in our private collective landowned in Scotland, because there is a tremendous amount of capital tied up in farms, although most farmers are not cash rich. They are land rich. If we enable them to build houses on their land, now, not all land is suitable, by no means. Some land, peat rock, you can't build on. Well, yes, okay.
Rachel Hamilton.
I completely agree with you about expanding permitted development rights. And I think also you make a very good point.
To the chair, please.
Sorry, presiding officer. The member makes a very good point around the demolition of buildings, which is currently not allowed, or changing the use of specific agricultural buildings or forestry buildings. So I want to know whether this is his own personal opinion or whether he has the backing of his own SNP colleagues.
Fergus Ewing, I can give you the time back.
Thank you. That's, I think, for the Minister to say. My attempt here is to persuade the Minister to take up and adopt measures, in addition to the plan which he's got, which contains many welcome steps, because I believe it would make a tremendous contribution to tackling the problem. And, of course, it wouldn't be so expensive, because if we enable people to use their own money instead of taxpayers' money, well, I mean, what's not to like about that? I mean, does that not make economic sense? So they are the sleeping giants of rural housing, our farmers, 50,000 of them. Just think what we can do if only even 10% of them take up this. It can transform it. They are the sleeping giant. Let's not leave them in a state of somnolence like some Scottish version of Rip Van MacWrinkle. Let's wake them up and deliver what we can do for Scotland, presiding officer. I'd intended to say an awful lot more, but lacking any skill and brevity, I've completely failed to do so. So I do hope the Minister will respond to what is a positively meant constructive suggestion, which I think would fly and would help him and help us all achieve the targets that have been set out today.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. I'm sure there will be further opportunities. We now move to the closing speeches. I call Rhoda Grant, who joins us remotely. Ms. Grant, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. And I want to draw members' attention to my register of interests in that I own a sixth share in a family home.
The rural point of order, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Sorry to interrupt Ms. Grant, but I'm afraid the audio from her transmission is not very, audible.
I was making the same point myself, Mr. Cole-Hamilton, but I think Ms. Grant was about to burst forth at a higher volume. Ms. Grant, if you wish to start again, around 7 minutes.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Loud and clear, Ms. Grant.
Perfect. Thank you. I would just repeat that I would draw members' attention to my register of interests where it shows I own a sixth share in a family home. The Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan is a first step, but it really does lack an ambition. As Mark Griffin said, we now have a rural housing emergency, and we often know what the issues are. Second homes and holiday lets inflate prices, a point made by Colin Smith and others. Also urbanisation, where people are moving to centres of population due to a lack of homes and services in our more rural communities. Housing costs are more expensive in rural areas because there are no economies of scale. For instance, the six new affordable homes that were built in Barra cost £1.4 million. That's £233,000 a unit. That's a huge cost in a rural area. And housing policy is made for urban areas. So until we have a policy made for rural areas by rural communities, we won't get the housing in those areas that we need. Mark Griffin and Rachel Hamilton talked about depopulation and the fact that the lack of housing was a key driver. Jamie Halcrow-Johnston also quoted the High report showing that young people were leaving due to a lack of housing. And that's true indeed for every generation, not just young people. People are being forced out because of the lack of housing. And Finlay Carson quoted Callum McLeod's work on the need to repopulate rural Scotland. Because if we don't, the economies will fail. With our young people being frozen out, we end up with an ageing population, and then there are no young people for service provision. Members from the Highlands and Islands recently met Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and they talked about housing being a priority for them, rural housing, because it's holding back economic development in those areas. And Mark Griffin talked about meeting with Salmon Scotland because they were flagging up to him the issues about a lack of housing for workers in those communities, and that's holding development and communities back. And Colin Smith also talked about the hospitality businesses who are really struggling to house staff. And that's true certainly in my own area in the Highlands and Islands, where many hospitality businesses are closing for 2 days a week because they don't have staff to cover shifts and they need to give staff time off to enable them to rest. And all services are suffering, health, education, many others, because there is no housing. And the Minister mentioned key workers, and that is a case in point, especially within the health service, where people cannot be recruited to take up posts. People want to move. Of course, the standard of living and living in remote rural communities is very attractive, but the inability to find a home to live in makes that impossible. And it's not always affordable housing. We find we can't attract GPs because there's no suitable housing available, and many other professionals who would need to be able to maybe buy a house but cannot do that because of the pressure on the market from second homes and holiday lets. Many people will build their own houses as well, but there is a cost involved in that. And I talked about the socially rented houses in Barra, but even self-build mean that transport cost for materials is higher, the access to planning, access to land, all of that causes problems. Many speakers talked about 10% not being enough when 17% of people in Scotland live in rural areas, and I would agree with that. But the 10% that is ring-fenced for rural areas also includes remote small towns and accessible rural, which is, to all intents and purposes, commuting communities. So if those areas are covered, actually remote rural is going to be left out, and that's where the housing crisis really happens. So we need to really focus on remote rural, not pursue the urbanisation of rural communities by including rural towns in this. I welcome that the government has said that they'll review the Croft Housing Grant Scheme. I think that is a positive move because the grant is not enough to build a house. It needs to increase. It needs to include workspace because crofting is a business. And I would suggest it needs to be paired with a self-build loan as well to make that affordable. And Kenny Gibson and Ariane Burgess talked about self-build and how it means that local companies are involved in the build, and that's less, that is more affordable, having local companies rather than large companies coming into the area and having the additional expense of workers having to stay over and travel expense, whereas using local procurement would be really good in providing jobs and a boost to the local economy. Mark Griffin made a number of really positive suggestions to the government, looking at the Crown Estate and how they might help taking some of the money that they make from their leases of the seabed, looking at empty homes, the compulsory sale of them to local people, and council tax on empty homes, all positive suggestions for the government. And Colin Smith also talked about good practice in his own area, which really needs to be promoted and also shared as good practice elsewhere. Presiding officer, we need a rural burden on every house that is built or renovated from government money. And I think that's something that needs to be pursued. We need to find a way of protecting rural homes, especially those that are created or renovated with public money, to stay within those local markets. So I would urge looking at maybe a two-market option or a rural burden to keep those homes in community hands. Alistair Allen talked about the Gaelic language and the impact on that by forcing people out of communities. Alec Cole-Hamilton talked about fuel poverty, again, another huge issue within rural areas. I'm very conscious I'm coming to the end of my time, but there were many constructive comments made in this debate, which I hope the government will listen to. I hope that they will listen to the fact that the action plan is not ambitious enough and it's a missed opportunity, and it needs to be developed by those who know and understand rural areas, because lazy mistakes are made due to a lack of understanding of the needs of rural communities.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Grant. I now call Miles Briggs up to 7 minutes, Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I, like others, very much welcome the opportunity to debate housing today on Government Time. And I'd like to thank the many organisations who have provided very useful briefings ahead of today's debate. And today's debate is the first opportunity for Parliament to look at the details around the Scottish Government's Rural and Island Housing Action Plan. So the question we need to ask ourselves today is this plan ambitious enough to meet the housing needs of our rural and island communities now and in the future? And I don't think it is, and I think many of the contributions today have pointed towards that, notably that it undercuts rural Scotland's entitlement to 17% of homes, which they should have been on the face of this plan, and that's something I think the government need to reflect on. As the briefing from Scottish Land and Estates makes clear, Scottish Government's Rural and Island Housing Plan is not ambitious or radical enough to deliver the step change needed to meet rural housing needs. In addition, the Scottish Government needs to consider the impact of other policy areas on the supply of housing, and the Minister himself touched upon this in his contribution around policy interventions. Because if we're going to develop long-term solutions, the Scottish Government need to focus on the causes of the housing crisis and avoid aspirating that by tinkering around the symptoms. Recent and proposed legislation continues to undermine the confidence in housing providers, which is helping to do the opposite of what ministers want to see in reducing supply available. And we've seen that with rent freeze and short-term let policies. Now, rural and island developments are full of challenges, and the primary challenge is viability, usually borne out by the cost of infrastructure due to the lower levels of existing connectivity and services in many areas. And whether community-led or, as we've heard, landowner-led, the principal challenges remain the same, as do the objectives in prioritising where housing needs to be in our local and rural communities. As the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations stated in their briefing, it's highly unlikely that we as a country will deliver 11,000 affordable homes in our remote rural and island communities if the affordable housing supply programme fails to be delivered on its target for 2032. Now, crucially, we know as things stand, the government's not on track to achieve its target right now around the supply of affordable housing, and that is actually slowing down in terms of delivery. The most recent quarterly statistics show huge drops in the numbers of approvals and starts under the affordable housing supply programme. And the fact is, the Scottish Government does not have a target for completions for this Parliament either. It's disappointing, but it is clearly not now on track to meet its Housing to 2040 policy either. Now, the time it takes for developers to be granted permission is also problematic, and there's little in the plan to suggest how priorities will change around this. And I think, again, that is a missed opportunity, and something I hope the Minister will reflect on beyond this debate, because I think looking at the bureaucracy we have in our planning system should be a priority. That needs to be reviewed, and we need to see how we can cut down times. The MPF4 was a missed opportunity as well to do some of that, and I thought both Jamie Halker-Johnson and Kenny Gibson's made some really important points with regards to the undertake-up of government schemes. That's something we've seen over the last 16 years of this government. But that's something we really need to see prioritised. For example, ministers have announced £25 million to help boost key workers' homes and tenancies in rural areas in April. The government don't know how many people that's supported. But it's clear we need to see when these announcements are made, not just for a press release, but actually on the ground, how they're taking up and delivered is critical. And to return to the point I made with regards to planning departments across the country, the average processing time for local housing applications, Homes for Scotland State, is 14 weeks. That is now 16% longer than the 12-week statutory framework and compares to 9 weeks pre-COVID in terms of getting an approval to build. And the fact is that SME builders, who will be tasked with delivering most of the individual builds and small-scale developments, are also in a difficult place. The government don't know how many home builders, SME home builders, there are in the country, but this is clear that we need to see what support can be given to them, and is reflected, like I say, in the decrease we've seen in active SME home builders in rural and island communities. That compares to 782 in 2007 to the latest figures around 2017-18, which was down to 465. 40% of SMEs has disappeared over this period of time, and we don't know what the figure looks like today. So we need to start then with who will do the work to bring homes back in, if they are empty homes or if they are building them, how SMEs will be able to deliver that. Presiding Officer, another important issue which was raised during the debate was that which Marie Curie have brought to our attention, and Emma Harper pointed this out, with regards to making sure that we have the homes in place which will look towards an ageing population and the needs. So according to MND Scotland, 23% of local authorities who have responded don't actually know a definition of accessible home, and they don't have that developed. Now, I welcome the fact that the Scottish Government have said that the new housing and Scottish Accessible Home Standard will provide that clarity, but that should have been really within this bill. Now, Rachel Hamilton outlined Scottish Conservative proposals and ideas around this, and I hope that the Minister will look at these, because we would want to see a step change for rural and island communities. We would want to see the establishment of a Scottish Housing Delivery Agency. We would want to see the implementation of a rural home just transition package. We would want to see the permitted development for rural homes to not just provide homes, but to look towards the businesses who are providing and sustaining our communities as well. And we would support the introduction of compulsory sale orders as well. Deputy Presiding Officer, to conclude, this week could see the first council in Scotland declaring a housing emergency, with Edinburgh City Council debating the call at full council on Thursday of this week. After 16 years of this government being in office, the housing crisis is deepening. This plan is a missed opportunity to focus on the real-world solutions which would help to realise the potential of our rural and island communities. And I support the amendment in Rachel Hamilton's name.
Thank you very much, Mr Briggs. I now call on the Minister to wind up the debate. Minister, around 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to start by thanking colleagues for their contribution during this debate. I think it's been mainly collaborative debate. I think going forward, Mark Griffin and Miles Briggs know I meet them on a regular basis, and we'll continue to discuss this going forward and continue to listen to any ideas that come forward and work with them on that. The contributions have clearly shown the importance of delivering more housing in rural and island areas to meet the needs of communities. The diverse makeup of our rural and island communities is something to be celebrated, and I'm proud that this government is focused on doing more to support these communities to thrive within this action plan. And I'll touch on that in a little second, but I just want to touch on some of the views that were kind of picked on earlier on. Rachel Hamilton obviously mentioned, as did a few others, about the 17% versus 10% target. And I'll reiterate, just to make sure, this 10% is the minimum. You know, hopefully we'll be able to deliver more. So the 17% isn't based on where funding goes, it's based on the target, and happy to look at that. And she also mentioned about, obviously, pressures in our own area. Happy to come down and visit and talk about that in our own area. Mark Griffin touched on about the second homes consultation. You'll know that's just finished, and the government's going to be moving forward with that. Conscious of time, if you just let me get into a little bit further, and I'll hopefully pick up some of the points you mentioned as well, Mr Carson, which I'm going to try and do. So in terms of that, obviously we talked about the £25 million key workers fund, which I think is important, and Sam and Scotland discussions continue. Alec Cole-Hamilton made a really important point around about fuel insecurity, and obviously the Scottish Government recognised that about the £30 million fund that came forward, and I think that's really important. Ivan McKee, I think, made a real range of some really important points around about economic development and where housing is key. And for me, one of the key things coming from a local government background as well is that the local housing strategy, local development plans and economic development strategies need to tie in together, and I think that's incredibly important. That's come through in some of the discussions in terms of that. And also working with agencies such as SCDA, I think that's really important. Off-site options are being considered, and I think that's really important. In terms of the land capture and issues, other issues I mentioned, obviously that will be brought forward, and there'll be discussions and debates around about that and the land reform bill that the government will be bringing forward. And the skills element, again, is incredibly important in terms of what that looks like.
Alex Alcro-Johnson touched on about the all-tenure approach, and I think we need to be working with Homes for Scotland, which we are on that particular point, and mentioned about stakeholders, and I'll touch on that, obviously with SLE, NFU, crofters, groups and employees, and I think that's really important. One of the key things, and I know there's been a debate in the Parliament about this, is a rural visa, the role of rural visa to make sure we're populating and getting people back and working in our communities as well, and hopefully the Conservatives will change their view on the role of the rural visa. Kenny Gibson obviously mentioned about project funding, which I think is important. We gave £1 million, as I said, to the Housing Trust to talk around about capacity in some of these groups, and that's an incredibly important point and something I heard really loudly and clearly in my visits during the summer. We need to be working with employees, and that's incredibly important. It comes back to the point I mentioned about talking to local authorities about housing strategy, the economic development strategy and their local development plans. Colin Smith, again, talked about South of Scotland Enterprise. I think that's really important and how we do that. Labour shortages, again, really important. And again, it comes back to some of the, maybe the wider issues, is trying to bring immigration policy back into this Parliament so we can use that role to try and get more people in, because it's not just skill shortages, these are labour shortages in terms of that. And come back to the role of local development plan, economic development strategy and local housing strategy in terms of that. And empty homes that he talked about, obviously we're continuing to discuss this. And I know in his own area, the funding for his own area increased by £15 million to £106 million this parliamentary term. Emma Harper mentioned about depopulation challenges. And again, coming back to the rural visa and immigration, I think that's really important. The VAT issue, I will pick up, and happy to meet with her in Dalbeattie to talk about, obviously, the project that's going to go in there. Ariane Burgess talked around about the role of community-led housing. I visited a project in Gairloch, and that was an incredible example of how that worked. And obviously, funding Community Housing Trust and South of Scotland Community Housing was an important part of that. And the placemaking is important. Alistair Allen touched on the balance of accommodation, I think that's important. The Stornoway Gazette, I think, just a few weeks ago reported on 100 STL lets in Harris alone, 180 in Harris alone. So there are funding challenges around about that, but it's not just around about funding, it's making projects work. And obviously we talked about local control areas, and that's up to each local authority in terms of that. Finlay Carson touched upon, and again this comes back to the key point, and I think it's really important in terms of the role of economic development, local development plans and local housing strategies being tied up, because we can't regenerate areas without having proper housing and vice versa. So again, we'd be happy to catch up when we discuss the broader issues in terms of that, but happy to take an intervention if I've got time, President Officer.
Finlay Carson.
The Minister for taking an intervention. Has he factored into the 10% of the 110,000 homes in rural areas been impacted on the lack of capacity and the lack of proper funding of planning departments in the likes of Dumfries and Galloway are really struggling because of the huge number of wind farm applications and their complete inability to deal with planning applications?
Minister.
I'm going to touch on this because just after I come back to it, I'll touch on what you know on that particular point. I think coming back to the point that Finlay, that Fergus Ewan mentioned, to Fergus Ewan, obviously I'll make sure he gets a reply to the letter. In terms of the point he raises, I've engaged with SLE, NFU and Crofton, and it will be an issue. I've got visits planned, and I do agree with him. There are huge opportunities, and I know that he'll be aware of the project at Tornagrain, which was a landowner that talked about that. So again, happy to talk to Mr Ewan about that, but I totally agree on the point he's talked around about, if I've got time, Presiding Officer.
Briefly, Minister.
Yeah, I'm grateful to the Minister. One of the key points of this, though, is reviewing the bureaucracy, which is holding back changes in these potential policies. Is that something the Government are willing to take forward above and beyond this plan today?
Minister.
The point Finlay Carson made in terms of that. Rhoda Grant obviously made the important point around about the Croft House Grant Scheme, and I think that's important as well, and obviously mentioned about rural burdens, and that's something that's mentioned in the report itself. So I just kind of want to get back to some of the other points that was kind of touched on in terms of that. In terms of planning, there is a consultation on resourcing going on at the particular moment, which he's talking around about, and we've been working closely with the RTPI, and I've been working with Joe Fitzpatrick on that. So we do take our commitment seriously, and one of the key things that's been talked around about during the debate was obviously around about the budget. The £3.5 billion term, the target of the term, hasn't changed. The profiling during that changes, as it does in other, budgets as well. But that £3.5 billion has continued at that figure. And that supports a total investment package of £18 billion and up to 15,000 jobs each year. A Rural and Housing Island Fund is also delivering for rural communities and providing an additional funding route for those not able to access traditional affordable housing that we've kind of talked about. So the next year, can you set out some of the priorities? Obviously, it's about delivering secondary legislation to enable councils to apply up to 100% premium and council tax rates from second homes from April 2024. Working closely with local authorities and registered social landlords, including the SFH, obviously, in terms of that.
working with the Scottish Homes Empty Partnership, local authorities and owners to bring more homes back into use. And obviously providing that financial support I mentioned to Communities Housing Trust and South of Scotland Community Housing Trust to enable them to support communities and drive capacity. Also commission independent research to support a review of affordable home ownership in rural and island areas. And of course working very closely with our five area-based teams who will be working with local authorities and others going forward. As I mentioned earlier, I want to thank the many organisations and individuals who have taken the time and effort to contribute to the development of the action plan. This action plan is a start. There's much work going on and will continue to go on. I think it says out the short-term, medium-term and long-term actions around about that. Now, since this government was elected, we've prioritised housing, and I'm proud to say that we'll continue to do so. And I'm glad we've had this debate today. It is a key part of our independent missions, it's a key part of our mission to prioritise our public services and focus on equality and opportunity. We have committed record investment in affordable housing, delivering over 10,000 affordable homes in rural and island areas since 2016. Introduced a game-changing Rural and Islands Housing Fund, and we've now published the Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. During engagement with stakeholders and the action plan, we heard that pieces of the jigsaw are all there with suggestions how they can be brought together. The Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan seeks to achieve that. As I said earlier, the ambitions set out in the Action Plan cannot be solely delivered by Scottish Government. It will require collaboration from a wide range of partners, including local authorities, housing associations, landowners, businesses and the Scottish Government agencies, including the enterprise agencies in Highlands and Islands and the south of Scotland, to name a few. From my conversations with partners, I strongly believe there's a willingness is there, and I look forward to working with colleagues and partners as we take forward the delivery of the action plan. I've been very clear that I'm no doubt about the vital role that housing plays in generating sustainable local economic growth. The appetite, enthusiasm and support for rural and island housing remains, even when things might seem insurmountable, challenging or complex. This government remains committed to working with partners to deliver the right homes in the right places to meet the needs of our rural and island communities. Therefore, I ask the Parliament to support the motion today. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. It is now time to move on to the next item of business. I'll allow a moment for front benches to organise themselves.